this week everything you ever wanted to know about growing almonds. The brilliant heritage of Edna Walling, creative landscaper, and even more about how permaculture works in the suburbs. When you look around any good, well-designed garden, you can see it's crammed with lovely landscaping ideas about different ways of using plants, rocks, stone walls, even changes of level. And let's be honest, when we ourselves see such gardens and cop onto these lovely ideas, we pinch them. That's good gardening. But there's one lady who, a couple of generations ago, created so many marvellous and original and quite unusual garden designs. She's become a legend in Australia, and later in the programme, we're going to be seeing some of her wonderful work. And now let's look at the work of a remarkable Australian landscaper.
Boredom of idleness drove me off in search of my life's work. Many were the fruitless avenues Mother and I explored before we hit upon the School of Horticulture. And I remember so clearly the dampening effect the principal's question, "Is she artistic?" had upon me. That's the last thing I was, I felt.
Australian landscape design didn't come of age until Edna Walling's contribution. Her creative genius and her philosophy of integrating the house and garden into the landscape have had a huge influence on our garden history. This is Glen Cairn, one of the original cottages that Edna Walling built at Bickleigh Vale. She had a vision. She wanted to create an ideal living environment, and she built a cluster of cottages at Bickleigh Vale with her own hands, plus the gardens, the dry stone walls and the pathways. And now they just look like they've sprung from the earth. Born in the 1890s, a little red-headed girl from the village of Bickleigh in Devon, her father and her would walk for miles over the moors, and they played guessing games about how far it was to that tree or how high is that stone wall. He taught her woodworking skills, all lessons that taught her perspective so valuable later in her life. On coming to Australia, she commenced a horticultural course at Burnley Horticultural College at the age of 19. She was one of the first women to graduate.
As luck would have it, the man I got to build my first wall made a splendid job of it, and on we went from garden to garden, building walls, always building walls. I was soon to discover that stone wall builders were few and far between. It was easy for me to design them, but to get them built was another matter.
Edna created at least six cottages and gardens at Bickleigh Vale. This is Hurst. It's a charming little cottage, reputedly the gardener's cottage. Now, Edna designed over 400 landscapes throughout Australia, and unfortunately, many of them have long since gone. But here at Bickleigh Vale, there are many that are still intact. The Bickleigh Vale houses don't fight with their landscape. There's a simplicity about them. Edna loved tiny windows, cool, clean paving areas, vine-covered pergolas, and the use of stone for chimneys, walls, and steps. Stone, water, and trees. They were the heart and soul of Edna Walling's landscapes. And this is a beauty. Edna Walling would have planted it many years ago. It's a scarlet American oak, very vibrant colours in autumn. But it's the stone walls and the stone steps that she's used to get from place to place in the garden. A lovely, gentle gradient, and it just brings the garden together. This is Down Derry, and it's the house that Edna built for her mother, and she lived here for many years. The garden around the house is massed and wild, as Edna loved gardens that self-seed and just lollop along.
These little informal woodland tracks can be very charming and refreshing. Of course, they wouldn't last a minute if the owners could afford a good gardener. He'd have it trimmed up to a perfect curve, and he would rush every leaf off to the compost heap immediately it had made a safe landing. Happily, the owner has little time for gardening and no money for assistance. Result, a garden full of pictures. Life is funny, isn't it?
Edna built Bickleigh Vale as a real village. She wanted the gardens to be quite joined together, so they were by little gates just like this. And still today, there's a real community spirit that persists. And this is the barn where Edna actually lived for many years until she moved to Budderham in Queensland. And it's got many Edna characteristics. It's got the rough stonework, the paving, even the chimney that she handicrafted herself. It's got wisteria-clad pergola and, of course, the many windows that look out onto the serenity of the garden.
Until the other day, I thought that the test of a garden's beauty and appeal was a camera. By that, I mean, did one feel impelled to go and get one's camera? Now I know there's another test. Does one, upon entering the gate, wonder which way to turn, all directions being so enticing?
Now you'll notice that Edna's gardens are not full of bright flowers. There's no great colour. It doesn't smack you in the eye. It's the lushness, the greenness of all the shrubs and trees that are absolutely beautiful. Perhaps just a copse of silver birch, the white trunks set against the green background, but no great colour. And that's what the beauty of an Edna Walling garden is all about. Keep your eyes open because Bickleigh Vale is very often open for the open garden scheme or on special occasions when you can come to visit these subtle and charming gardens. It's easy to forget that Edna Walling has had such a great influence on Australia's landscape design, but I think she's one of the most powerful, determined and energetic ladies that you'll ever find. And I'm sure that you'd agree, looking at Bickleigh Vale is like something out of last century.
Gardeners are given to wild dreams, an incurable disease. Even 99 failures out of 100 tries won't cure it. Let's hope they never find a cure.